Hello and welcome to today's webinar on social, emotional, and physical well-being for youth in transition from the foster care system. My name is Erin Russ. I'm a program associate at the American Youth Policy Forum. In case you're not familiar with AYPF, we are a nonpartisan, nonprofit organization focused on bridging policy, practice, and research through professional learning opportunities for policymakers at the national and state levels. We focus on a wide range of issues involving education, youth development, and workforce development. Through these events and convenings, we aim to help young people, especially those in underserved communities, be successful in college, careers, and beyond. We offer events and resources on topics such as secondary school reform, college and career readiness and success, dropout prevention and recovery, after school and expanded learning time, and youth development. We are particularly focused on youth who face challenges to success, such as those who come from low-income backgrounds, students with disabilities, youth in the foster care system, immigrant youth, and youth involved in the court system. You can find out more about the work that we do at www.AYPF.org, and we also invite you to follow us on Twitter. You can see our Twitter handle on the screen in front of you, AYPF_tweets. And you can use the hashtag AYPFEvents to follow our various events. Before we discuss today's topic, I want to provide a few logistical points about today's webinar. In the event of any technical difficulties, you may dial 1-800-263-6317 to reach GoToWebinar's technical support line. Also, if you happen to lose connectivity, please just go ahead and log back into the webinar. At any point during today's webinar, you may type a question for our presenters in the questions box on your screen to the right, and we'll do our best to answer as many as we can. Please be sure to identify if the question is for a particular panelist. This webinar will be recorded, and the audio portion with all the slides will be posted on the AYPF website. Also, when you exit the webinar, you will receive a very brief online survey about the webinar and its value to you. I encourage you to take a few moments to fill that out and send us your feedback as it helps us improve our programming. Today's webinar is about youth transitioning out of the foster care system. Each year, there are over 400,000 children and youth in the foster care system nationwide. Approximately 26,000 will transition out of the system each year. As youth move out of care, they quickly lose access to support services and systems. Research tells us that youth within and transitioning from the foster care system are more likely to experience long-term adverse experiences like unemployment, homelessness, suicide, and incarceration. Each of these experiences diminishes the likelihood of success in education, careers, and adulthood. There are important policy, program, and research considerations around this population, and our presenters today will share several findings and practices that can inform the work of systems that support these youth as they transition into lifelong independence and success. First today, we'll be hearing from Barbara Langford. Barbara is with the Youth Transition Funders Group Foster Care Work Group. She recently co-authored Connected by 25, a plan for investing in the social, emotional, and physical well-being of older youth in foster care. She'll be sharing some of the findings and implications for policy. Next, we'll hear from Wayne Sims. Wayne is president and CEO of KVC Health Systems Incorporated, and Wayne will be sharing the case management approach KVC has taken for youth in the foster care system in Kansas, with a special focus on trauma-informed approaches. We'll pause after Wayne's presentation for a brief Q&A, after which we'll hear from Mary Lee. Mary is the National Transitional Living Coordinator for Youth Villages, and she'll be sharing their work to support older youth who are transitioning out of the foster care system. Finally, we'll finish with a whole group Q&A. Throughout the presentations, we encourage you to type your questions into the questions box, and while there's no guarantee we'll get to them all, we will certainly do our best. First today, we'll be hearing from Barbara Langford. Barbara, please take it away.
Great. Thank you, Erin. I'm Barbara Langford, the director of the Youth Transition Funders Group. YTFG is a network of funders that work together to ensure all young people are connected by 25 to relationships and supports that they need to effectively transition to adulthood. YTFG organizes its membership into three work groups, one of which is the Foster Care Work Group. Today, I'd like to share the Foster Care Work Group's efforts to create a new investment agenda focused on social, emotional, and physical well-being for young people who have experienced foster care, highlighting the definition of well-being that the group created, a framework for describing and communicating what well-being means for older youth who have experienced foster care, as well as to highlight some of our recommended investment strategies for public and private funders seeking to improve social, emotional, and physical well-being outcomes for this population. So why a focus on well-being for the Foster Care Work Group? Well, well-being is a significant gap in the field of child welfare. While federal child welfare policy is founded upon three pillars of safety, permanency, and well-being, few public agencies see assuring well-being as their primary responsibility as a child welfare entity. We also know that young people in foster care typically have lower levels of well-being than their peers, which not surprisingly stems both from their experiences before entry into care as well as their experiences while in care. We also know that emotional and behavioral challenges are strong predictors of placement instability, which in turn affects a myriad of other challenging outcomes. So if a young person's not able to effectively manage their social and emotional challenges, it makes it very hard to connect in a community, to develop and sustain relationships, to succeed in school, and to find and keep a job. The group came together in late 2011 to really think through a new phase of work, and we're inspired by then ACYF Commissioner Brian Samuels' new focus on well-being, and really took that issue to heart to dedicate time and attention to thinking through understanding the range of issues associated with social, emotional, and physical well-being for this particular population, and to think about what are the important strategies to move the dial on these outcomes. So the investment rationale for this piece of work really operates from the theory that investments in social, emotional, and physical well-being will lead to success in education, employment, housing, and family permanence. So these are important contributory investments to really help set young people on the path to an effective transition to adulthood. As the group considered the topic of social emotional well-being, a first step in the group's efforts was really to craft a vision and definition of what well-being means for this particular population. And the vision that the Foster Care Work Group landed on is here, that youth and young adults who have experienced foster care have lifelong personal, family, and community connections. The notion of those connections were front and center in the Foster Care Work Group's deliberations. That they help them to navigate life's ups and downs in a healthy and effective way. Everyone will have ups and downs. The important part is that you're able to navigate those ups and downs in both a healthy and effective way, to deal with problems, to meet their needs, to see opportunity in the future, that sense of hopefulness we want for all young people, and importantly, to realize success. This vision is importantly founded upon a normalcy standard, that youth transitioning from foster care need and deserve the same opportunities, experiences, and high expectations as all other young people in the community. So using that definition and vision, we then embarked on an effort to create a framework for describing what well-being means for older youth who have experienced foster care. And this infographic really illustrates the broad array of various domains that really make up what it means to be a successful and well adult. That includes social development, mental wellness, physical health, economic success, safety and permanency, and intellectual potential. And in crafting this framework, the Foster Care Work Group wanted to ensure that it was broad, that it was a comprehensive definition to really mark milestones of success in multiple life domains, that it was inclusive, that recognizing young people transitioning from foster care come from diverse backgrounds with a wide range of strengths, skills, capacities, protective factors, needs, and challenges, that the domains of well-being presented are interconnected. Certainly, there's some clear and distinct markers for success in each of the domain, but achieving wellness in any one of these areas requires growth and development in others. We wanted this framework to be complementary to make a contribution to the field as it complements other existing frameworks, while also expanding those frameworks to reflect the opportunities and unique needs of this specific population. And developmentally focused. The group also wanted to ensure that the this framework focused on the age range of 14 to 25, recognizing that there are critically important developmental markers and tasks that a young person has to take on in both adolescence and the developmental phase of emerging adulthood. So our intention was that this framework would complement and contribute to other frameworks in the field. This next graphic presents some additional detail in terms of what that framework encompasses. So it goes into a bit more specificity. In terms of cognitive functioning, our vision is all young people should have the opportunity and support to maximize their intellectual ability and functioning. That includes being able to be exposed to healthy and stimulating environments, to have critical thinking and problem-solving skills, or able to set and commit to realistic and productive goals. A second domain focuses on social development, being able to cultivate a strong and resilient self-identity, and to cultivate supporting and nurturing relationships, to feel hopeful about life in the future. That includes things like having a strong sense of self-efficacy and self-esteem, having the capacity to make good decisions, cultivating healthy and supportive networks, being able to communicate effectively and use healthy coping skills, for example. Importantly, the framework also highlights having support for a young person's spiritual journey, recognizing the importance of spirituality in well-being as well. A third domain is mental wellness, being able to manage your mental health and wellness, to manage mental distress in a healthy way, to access resources, to manage a health diagnosis, to be a full participant in treatment decisions, that you have trauma-specific education, for example. And a final domain in the social, emotional, and physical range is physical health, to maximize your physical health, strength, and functioning. Being able to have access to a spectrum of healthy activities that reflects a young person's individual interests and capacities. Being able to have access to information to make health-informed decisions, to engage in healthy behaviors, to have health insurance, and access to health services. So those first four domains really encompass how the foster care work group is defining social, emotional, and physical well-being. You'll see two additional domains, safety and permanency, which encompasses ensuring that young people are physically and psychologically safe and free from abuse and neglect, and permanency, belonging to a family for a lifetime, as well as economic success, which includes markers related to education, employment, and housing. So in our definition, well-being really needs to encompass both the social, emotional, and physical well-being sides, as well as safety and permanency and economic success. For a number of reasons, the foster care work group chose to focus on social, emotional, and physical well-being, largely because we saw that as a gap in the field. Also because our members were investing significantly in safety and permanency already, and that in terms of economic success, an earlier document, a companion investment agenda, focused on education, employment, and housing. And this new document is intended to complement and extend existing work that we had done in the topic of economic success. So for those reasons, the resulting investment agenda largely focused on social, emotional, and physical well-being. So based on that definition and framework, the group then identified a series of recommended investment strategies that we encourage both public and private funders to invest in order to improve outcomes related to well-being for young people currently in or transitioning from the foster care system. And I'll briefly highlight those strategies here. You can always go to the full document for additional detail and information. The first set of strategies relates to investing in improving, expanding, and sustaining practice through things like developing functional assessment tools that helps caseworkers to really assess and measure progress related to social, emotional, and physical well-being, creating practice models, ensuring a focus on vulnerable subpopulations, and providing professional development training for folks who are caregivers and work directly with young people. A second important set of investment strategies relates to investments in policy and advocacy, including policies that require the most family-like placement setting, encouraging states to extend 4E eligibility beyond the age of 18, ensuring well-being is an important component of effective transition planning, and ensuring access to Medicaid to 26, including mental and physical health supports. A third category of investment strategies relates to investments in community supports and opportunities. These are investments that ensure young people have access to healthy opportunities to build their passions and interests, to build physical health, to remove system barriers to participation, to normalizing activities and activities that really support social, emotional, and mental health. Support for caregivers in ensuring and supporting a young person's participation in those types of activities, joining a sports team, joining a club after school, for example, and support for spirituality, an oftentimes overlooked aspect of well-being within the child welfare system. A fourth category of investments are investing in cross-systems collaboration. The framework we developed is necessarily broad, and therefore requires the coordinated efforts of many public systems. So these investments call for work to ensure well-being issues are included in broader youth initiatives, supporting leadership, planning structures, and data systems at the state and local level, and developing strategic partnerships with other youth-serving systems that play a critical role in influencing a young person's well-being, including the courts, workforce and education, mental health and wellness, physical health, and transportation and housing. A final set of investment strategies relate to investments in research, demonstration, and evaluation, helping the field to ensure that we have the capacity to measure well-being, clarifying what we need to know more about, including things like the longer-term effects of psychotropic medication, what types of therapies and placement settings work best for older youth, and designing new interventions that focus on social, emotional, and physical well-being. So that provides you with a brief overview of the Foster Care Workgroup's definition, framework, and recommended investment strategies related to social, emotional, and physical well-being. I want to highlight our members who played a key role in the development of this document, including Mary Lee from Youth Villages, who's a co-panelist today. These folks gave generously of their time and good thinking to produce this document. And to learn more, feel free to visit us on our website and to download a full copy of the report. Thanks, Erin. Back to you.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Barbara. That is a really interesting framework that you have created with the Foster Care Workgroup. And I think we have some questions rolling in, and we just want to remind our audience to type your questions to us in the chat box, and we will pause after our next presentation and get to those. We also want to remind our audience that the PowerPoint from today's webinar will be posted online immediately following the conclusion of our webinar, and a recorded broadcast will also be posted shortly after. So now we want to transition into our next presenter, who is Wayne Sims from KVC Health Systems. Wayne, go right ahead.
Thank you, Erin. My intent today is to give you a broad overview of KVC, putting today's topic into context, the development of our model for addressing childhood trauma for youth in foster care. These necessary social-emotional supports improve safety and permanency, as well as improve long-term well-being. KVC Health Systems is the parent organization of a number of subsidiaries, all 501c3 nonprofit organizations, and I'm the president and CEO of KVC Health Systems, providing administrative and corporate supports to individual subsidiary corporations. KVC provides direct services in Kansas, Nebraska, Missouri, West Virginia, and Kentucky. And we also currently have a loaned executive in Washington, D.C. The primary goal in D.C. is to apply lessons learned in Kansas to help address issues highlighted in the lawsuit settlement agreement under which they've operated since 1989. This next slide represents services we currently provide, and you'll see the greatest emphasis on community-based services. For the purpose of today's discussion, I'm going to give you a little background on our development of services in Kansas that led to the trauma systems therapy initiatives that I'll be discussing. Our roots are in Kansas, where we have operated for the past 43 years and where we have the broadest continuum of services, including family preservation, in-home therapy, outpatient, foster care, relative care, adoption, and aftercare services. And another Kansas subsidiary provides psychiatric hospital and psychiatric residential treatment services, resulting in our full continuum. Kansas is unique in that it truly is one of the few states managing child welfare services entirely through private contracts. KBC has had the privilege of being an original contractor for family preservation, reunification, and adoption services since the system reform was launched in 1996 and is the only contractor who has operated continuously since that time. As a private contractor, we are responsible for case management of 50% of all family preservation services, foster care, reunification, and adoption services in the state, accountable for measurable outcomes and indicators directly tied to federal outcomes of safety, permanency, and well-being. You see some of the most significant achievements include being the first state to successfully exit from a children's rights lawsuit due to vast improvement across the system. You'll also see a right-sizing of congregate care increasing from about 70% to 97% of all the children in out-of-home care living in a family setting. Matching over 2,000 children and youth with adoptive families since becoming responsible for adoption in 2005. And significant increases in siblings placed together, placement stability, and so forth. All of these are pertinent to this conversation as they reduce the trauma youth in foster care experience. So we knew we were making a great impact on safety and permanency and very likely improving long-term well-being through these outcomes. But while we were pleased with these outcomes, we continually ask ourselves if it's good enough. With a focus on our values and what we had want for our own children, the answer is it's never good enough. So we continually ask, what more, what else? What about the small percentage who still have long lengths of stay in residential settings, who are chronic inpatient users, whose placements disrupt? And for the large percentage for whom we've improved safety and permanency, what about their long-term well-being? Are we really making a difference in their long-term success? Our continual questioning of what more and what else always leads us to research. And one that is routinely cited is the Adverse Childhood Experiences Study, the ACEs study. You're probably familiar with this study and ongoing collaborative research between the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention and Kaiser Permanente in San Diego. This provides staggering proof of the health, social, and economic risks that result from childhood trauma. Clearly, acts of abuse, neglect, and a child's removal from their families and homes represent significant adverse childhood experiences that, left unaddressed, lead to very negative predictors of long-term well-being. The chart on the next page represents just one example of the impact of adverse childhood experiences on adult suicide. I think you'll agree the results are alarming. The next slide is one more example showing the increased predictors for adult alcoholism. Again, a very alarming piece of research. While I won't take you through every chart, these same trends apply to so many negative outcomes. This study is just one example of the research that has been highly motivating to us to keep us pushing to raise the bar further in safety and permanency, and that third leg of the stool, if you will, well-being. And beyond the ACEs study, there is ample additional research showing the importance of addressing trauma. While I won't read all of these citations to you, I'll tell you just some of the takeaways for us. Traumatic stress can be acute, chronic, and complex, and it is the rule as opposed to the exception in foster care. Children's bad behavior is often really an adaptation to trauma. We must recognize the signs and symptoms of child traumatic stress and how they vary in different age groups. Early experiences, both positive and negative, have a decisive impact on how the brain is wired. We see this played out every day with youth in foster care. Youth removed from their families due to abuse and neglect often struggle with emotional and behavioral instability. Youth with challenging behavior problems are more likely to experience placement instability. Youth experiencing placement instability are more likely to exhibit emotional and behavioral stress responses, and youth with emotional and behavioral stress responses are less likely to experience permanency or achieve well-being in life. And we also see it through that throughout the child welfare system with caregivers or teachers or behavioral health techs, employers, and so forth. They often assume behavioral problems stem from defiance versus a response to a traumatic event. They often feel ill-equipped to address youth's needs. They may resort to trying to out-control youth, which generally makes matters worse, or they may ask that youth be removed, and they lack experience in real-world experience training to prepare them to work with children experiencing traumatic stress. This lack of system support often leads to suspension or expulsion, placement disruptions, or terminated employment. There are also system barriers to addressing trauma, such as lack of public awareness regarding the impact of trauma on children in the child welfare system. There is a lack of trauma-informed service providers utilizing evidence-based treatment models with fidelity. There is often poor coordination and communication across providers, and a high anxiety environment where trauma is found in almost every position within the system. So what we do with these depressing facts and research? Well, what we always do in cases like this, we seek out experts and try to learn from the best. Ideally, evidence-based proven practices. This led to a lengthy and full review of many models for addressing trauma. After much research and comparison, KBC sought out Drs. Glenn Sachs and Heidi Ellis, the purveyors of trauma systems therapy. Dr. Sachs described himself appropriately as a physician scientist. He's chair of the NYU Department of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry and director of the NYU Child Studies Center. And he was previously at the Children's Hospital in Boston and Harvard Medical School. Our emphasis is on TST as a preventative measure, a way to inform and strengthen social-emotional supports throughout the child welfare system, as well as a way to help children and youth learn to self-regulate, to improve their emotions and keep them in check. We study many modalities and assess TST as the one best suited for us because, among other things, we believed it covers the broadest age range. We think it allows for flexibility for all subgroups, while not yet evidence-based, that is supported and research is underway. It also addresses a system with strong emphasis on relationships. Simplified, we like TST because it is both a clinical model as well as an organizational model. TST addresses goals I mentioned earlier. It's a model to treat children and youth to help them learn to appropriately manage their emotions, and a model that supports understanding of trauma within the child welfare system. It helps staff, caregivers, and other stakeholders better understand the impact of trauma and the need for providing social and emotional supports. So we began by bringing Dr. Sachs and his team to KBC about 6 years ago, first in Kansas, to train clinicians, as the model was originally developed for the field of mental health. We then involved KBC leadership from various areas who worked very closely with Dr. Sachs and his NYU team to create adaptations specific to foster care, adaptation of training manuals specific to case managers, behavioral health techs, and foster families. In addition, our staff are constantly working in partnership with Dr. Sachs to create innovative emotional regulation, or as we refer to it, ER drills, and new activities for system support and training. Examples would be things like safely getting youth to a high emotional state to elicit physical responses to replicate those they feel when trauma is triggered, like increased heart rates, turning red, clenching fists. Then, teaching or helping them discover ways to manage the physical emotions that have historically led them to that fight, flight, or freeze. They learn emotional regulation, and professionals and families throughout the system learn to help support them to increase success. This has led to the development of fidelity measures, book reviews, training through case presentations, training of trainers, continual strategy development, and on-site and online education for foster families. It's led to initiatives throughout the KBC system, but also to expanded contract in Washington, D.C. to implement this TST system. Another result has been the creation of the NYU KBC Midwest Trauma Training Center through a SAMHSA grant. Our initiative has also led to numerous consultations, some as a result of our identification as a child welfare best practice organization by the Annie E. Casey Foundation. We think it's important to take this to scale across the field and also know the importance of having research behind it. So we have various research projects in place at this time. We believe from early indicators and reports that these will result in evidence to support this model. Some of the goals we hope to achieve include improving the ability of youth to form strong relationships, to identify their triggers, to regulate their emotions appropriately, and to develop and grow into healthy, successful adults. Some of the measurable outcomes and indicators we'll monitor are listed on this next slide. Examples would include continued reduction in placement disruptions, continued reduction in youth aging out, increased adoptions of older adolescents, and increased success in education and employment. So while we maintain focus on prevention of youth aging out and improving well-being through initiatives such as TST, and while we hope to see the day where no youth ages out without a permanent family and support system, unfortunately, that is not yet the case. So as I want to share some of the strong supports that are available in Kansas for youth who do age out. Here we have tuition waivers, medical cards, independent living, and car maintenance support, case management support. We also have a new law that was originated through a Senate bill that supports youth who have experienced frequent moves and school disruptions to high school graduation by creating greater consistency across school districts, identifying core classes and requirements. We also have computer camps and educational training vouchers and various supports through Gear Up. And with that, you should see my email on the screen. So if there are any questions we don't have time to address today, please don't hesitate to contact me. And with that, I'll pass it back to you, Aaron.
Wayne, thank you so much. That was really interesting information about the TST approach that KBC is taking in Kansas. And we have gotten several questions in during both your and Barbara's presentations that I want to pose to you both now. And Barbara, this first question is for you. And both of these questions have to do with research. You mentioned the need to invest in more research around youth in the foster care system and the transition process. Can you talk more about maybe what kind of research, what that would look like, and then how investors can be convinced to make that investment?
Great, sure. The investment strategies related to research, demonstration, and evaluation really focused around four core priorities. One, helping folks really think about how to effectively measure well-being, how to really operationalize that framework into measurable constructs. So if a young person enters into care, we can get a baseline of their status of emotional, social, and physical well-being, and then be able to track their progress toward improving outcomes in those areas. So really, first and foremost, simply expanding our ability, child welfare agencies and other caregivers' ability to really measure and track well-being. A second set of priorities were around critical research gaps in the field where we don't know a lot of information yet. And those centers around what's the long-term effects on brain health of psychotropic medication, for example. Exploring what are the types of treatments and therapies that work best for this particular population who have had their unique sets of experiences. Figuring out what are the characteristics of a placement setting, particularly as states are considering extension of care past the age of 18, what are the types of placement settings that work best for older youth in care, and what are the characteristics and attributes of caregivers that can effectively support this population of older youth and young adults. Thinking through what are the particular interventions, building off of the work that KVC has done, what are the interventions that work well, and expanding the evidence base for determining best practice for programs and supports and therapies that really support social, emotional, and physical well-being. So those are the core research questions and recommendations for investment strategies in the research and evaluation area. In terms of effectively making the case to both public and private funders to invest in this area, I think simply that rationale that these investments are central to a young person's ability to succeed in adulthood. Without being able to manage those social, emotional, and physical health challenges, it becomes incredibly difficult to do things like create and sustain relationships, to be able to successfully attend school and succeed in an academic environment, to be able to acquire skills and be able to find and keep a job. All of those really central functions as a human being are essential. So anyone seeking to improve a myriad of other outcomes, making sure to articulately be able to demonstrate the contributions of these investment strategies in social and emotional and physical well-being and the impact that they have on other related outcomes that many folks are seeking to see for older youth who are transitioning from foster care.
Wonderful. Thank you for that answer and explanation. And I also want to encourage our audience members to continue submitting your questions in the chat box at the bottom right of your webinar screen. And then, Wayne, we also had a question come in for you about research, specifically wondering if you can elaborate a little more on the research process that KVC went through leading up to your selection of TST as a model, if you can talk about any other models or strategies out there.
We had a team of staff members who actually went out and began looking at the different models that they were able to run across. We are a member of the National Trauma Network, and so we were exposed to a number of systems there. What we liked about the TST system was that it was one that impacts the entire system, courts, schools, families, organizations, and in reality, when you are involved in foster care, all of those are important aspects of that. And so TST was the broadest one that addressed an entire system, thus trauma systems therapy, and that's why we opted to go with TST.
That's great. Thank you. And we will continue monitoring our questions, and we will return to a Q&A at the end. But right now, we'd like to transition to Mary Lee. Mary is with Youth Villages as the National Transitional Living Program Coordinator. Mary, take it away.
Great. Thank you so much, Erin, and thank you, everyone, for joining us today. I want to talk a little bit about our Transitional Living Program at Youth Villages. Just to give you some background on the program, it was created in 1999 through a generous grant from the Day Foundation. And what happened was Clarence Day came into our organization, and we actually started as a residential provider, and he asked our CEO, he was like, tell me what you're not doing well. At that point, we had started collecting research and outcome data around the young people who were transitioning from our residential programs, and we found that many of them were ending up homeless, incarcerated, unemployed, early parents. And so we told Clarence that, and he said, well, let's create a program. And so in 1999, we actually benchmarked other programs, and that's how we came up with our model. It's really a systemic approach, and it incorporates multiple aspects of the youth natural environment. We look at community, peers, family, their their school, and we really try to make the model really strength-based and individualized for the young adult. Just to give you some quick hits about our program, we have served 6,300 young people since the program started, and on any given day, that's roughly 770 young people. Our locations include Florida, Georgia, Massachusetts, Mississippi, North Carolina, and Tennessee. The program objectives really focus on permanency. We know that a lot of our young people actually go back to their birth families, so we try to help them negotiate or try to figure out how to balance those relationships to make sure that they're healthy. We also do what we call perm packs with our young adults and support of caring adults who may be in their lives, and that's just a written statement saying what the adult agrees to do for the young person. We focus a lot on education and making sure that our young adults are able to leverage their education to find employment and not just a minimum wage, but a living wage. We also focus on housing. We do not provide brick and mortar housing. Instead, we really focus on the young person leveraging their natural supports and look for housing in the community that they can maintain once they discharge from our program. When the young person comes into the program, we do the Ansel-Casey Independent Living Skills Assessment, and we look at where they're at and what we need to focus on while they're in the program. And that can be anything from learning how to grocery shop, balance a budget, learning how to drive, any of those types of things that sometimes we forget that our young people don't have those skills since they didn't grow up in a normal family situation. We also really focus on youth involvement and engaging our young people in their treatment plan. They're really the driving force, and they get to determine what goals they want to work on. We also have what we call peer-to-peer events where we bring in our young people once a month, and that gives them the opportunity to interact with each other and build a support system of their peers. Some other components of our program includes having very low caseloads. We actually have what we call our RTL specialist who works with a young person, and they have caseloads of 8 to 10. The specialist is focused on just those 8 to 10 cases. They see their young people a minimum of once a week, and that can be more if the young person needs it. They also communicate through phone calls and text messaging throughout that time as well. And our specialists are on call 24/7 support to our young people. So if a young person called at 3 o'clock in the morning because they were having a crisis, our specialists would either respond by phone or in person. The average length of stay for the program is 7 to 9 months. And again, that's really based on the individual young person and what they need. If they need additional support, we would keep them in the program longer. So we're going to jump to some of the outcome data now and talk about our program evaluation and outcome data. So we actually want to include our youth and hear what they have to say about what's going well with the program, what they don't like, ways we can improve it. And so in order to do that, we actually have our young adults complete satisfaction surveys every 2 months. And so that gives us feedback, and we use that and incorporate it into our program model. Another thing about our research and outcome data is that we track our young people at 6, 12, and 24 months, and we look to see if they've maintained stable housing, where they are in their educational path, if they're employed. We look at their social support and basic living skill level, and then we also look to see if they've had any legal involvement. In the next few slides, I'm going to show you are some of our outcome data that we actually have for the 6,300 young people that we've served. The first slide is around demographics. As you can see, roughly 50% female and male, and slightly more Caucasian than African American youth. The next slide shows you our age at admission. The program was specifically developed for 17 to 21 year olds, and so you'll see a good mix of our young people are between the 17 and 18 age range. The next slide shows you youth served by region. We started the program in Tennessee, and it's statewide in Tennessee, so you'll see a larger number in Tennessee. However, we do provide services in other states, including Alabama, Florida, Mississippi, Massachusetts, and Georgia, so you'll see some of the other numbers in there. And the next slide talks about our discharge location. We define success as a young person who is living in a home or home-like environment. And so at discharge, 86% of our young people are successful. The next slide will show you the satisfaction of our program. And this, not only are the young people doing the surveys every 2 months while they're in the program, but when they discharge, they also complete a satisfaction survey. And then you'll see that 91% are overall satisfied with the program. The next slide talks about success at follow-up. Again, we track our young people at 6, 12, and 24 months. And you can see at 6 months, 88% are still successful. And at 24 months, it dropped off a little bit, and it's 83%. The next slide talks about youth reporting their trouble with the law. And this is really self, the young person gets to define what they deem trouble with the law, and that can range from anywhere from like a moving citation, speeding ticket, or it could be breaking probation, being arrested, any of those type of things. So the young person is really self-defining this and for themselves. And as you can see, that our success rate at six months is 84%. The black bar across the screen shows you what the national average is. And that is based on the Chapin Hall survey. But at age 21, nearly half of former fostering youth had been arrested. So that just shows you our program compared to the natural average without support. The next two slides talk about school and employment. The first slide just shows you that the number of young people or the percentage that are in school graduated or employed. And then the following slide gives you a breakdown of whether they're in school only or their school and work or work only. And as you can see that those percentages are very high as compared to the national average. The following slide talks about correctional facilities. We also track whether our young people are having any other types of placements and if they've been put into in a correctional facility. And as you can see, our percentage is very low, 5% at 6 months, 12 months, and then 9% at 24 months. And the national average is nearly a third of former foster youth has spent time in a correctional facility at age 21. And the next slide talks about selected outcome data. So we know some of the trends for our young adults, and we're always collecting new and additional information to figure out how we can really modify our program model to best support their needs. So we've started collecting data on the number of young women ever pregnant, youth who are parenting a child, includes male and females, and then youth receiving mental health services, and then the percentage of those youth who are receiving those services on a regular basis. And so that just helps us to understand what needs are in our program. We've actually started doing specific assessments around parenting skills, and so then we're able to implement them with our young adults who are pregnant and parenting based off of collecting this outcome data and finding out that that was a need for our young people. The next slide just gives you information about our response rate. We all know that this population is very transient and it's sometimes hard to track them down. We actually have a research department that is dedicated to doing all of our outcome data. And they have a call center in which they call young adults. They try to find them on LexisNexis. They Facebook them. They text them. And so I feel like all of those strategies help us really be able to get a response rate and be able to collect this important data. The next slide just gives you the report, the Chapin Hall study on Midwest evaluation on adult functioning for former foster youth at age 21. And that is where the comparison came from the national standard. One of the other things that I want to share with you about our transitional living program is that we're currently going through a randomized clinical evaluation. We have a little over 1,300 young adults who are part of the study. Roughly 60% are getting RTL services and 40% are in the controlled group. We have started our one-year follow-ups and feel like we'll be completed with those at the end of January. And we are expecting an implementation evaluation hopefully at the end of this year or maybe the early spring. And then our impact analysis, we're expecting late fall of 2004 or early spring of 2015. And really the evaluation is examining the difference that our RTL program makes for the population. And really we're looking for the impact on a range of outcomes, including education, employment, health, and financial security. We want to provide this information to policymakers and practitioners who might be interested in improving the lives of these young people. And the next slide, I inserted a quote from Dr. Mark Courtney. He works at Chapin Hall, and he is actually the principal investigator for our clinical trial. And this is a quiz that I thought really captured it all, that we're all working together to figure out what's going to work for our young people, and that includes collecting a lot of outcome data, includes implementing best practices, and really trying to include the youth voice and ask them what they want and how to best provide services for them. So his quote says, this is one of the largest experimental evaluations ever conducted in the child welfare services field, and the largest by far of a program focused on improving the transition to adulthood for former foster youth. It will provide invaluable evidence to the field regarding what works for foster youth. So I thank you guys for letting me share my information about our transitional living program. My contact information is listed on the last slide, and Erin, I'm going to turn it back to you.
Great. Thank you so much, Mary. It's really interesting to hear about the work happening at Youth Villages through the Transitional Living Program. And we've had some really great questions coming in. I want to encourage our audience to keep your questions coming, and thank you for the ones you've sent so far. And before we dive into our Q&A session, I'll just remind audience members that today's PowerPoint presentation will be posted on our website immediately following the webinar, and a recording of the webinar session will also be posted shortly after. So, Mary, I want to dive into a question that was asked for you and the Transitional Living Program. First, can you just briefly mention again the average age of your youth who are transitioning out of the foster care system? And then maybe talk a little bit about a little more about how you use your survey data, specifically if you provide any aftercare services.
Yeah, so the program was specifically developed for young people between ages of 17 and 21. I would say on average most of the young people are around 18. Typically we get referrals when the young person is 17 and a half or on the cusp of aging out, and so we try to step in to make sure that they don't experience homelessness in their transition from state custody to being independent and on their own. We use the outcome data, like I said, just to really focus in on what we need to develop for our young people. So in learning that 50% of our young women had ever been pregnant, we really saw a need, and we developed sexual health modules. I think there are like five of them that we work on with all of our young adults. And then we also incorporated doing parenting skill assessment and then also teaching them skills on how to parent their young children. And so that's just one example of what we looked at and said, you know, if this is where there's a big need, what can we add to the program to support that need?
That's great. Thank you. And Mary, you also mentioned that your transitional living specialists have very small caseloads. So can you talk first about the importance of that and then how you're able to arrange that?
Yes, absolutely. So a lot of these people have very individualized needs, and a lot of times when they first come into the program, we have to focus on just those basic needs. Like some of them come to us when they're living in a homeless shelter, or some have, you know, are on the cusp of being kicked out of school, and so, and some of them actually have severe mental health needs and are really looking for support just so they can maintain living in the community. So that's kind of one of the reasons why we decided we wanted it to be an intense service and that we wanted caseloads to be low so that that specialist could really give them that individualized attention that they need. Also, since the specialist sees our young person once a week and then has other communication and contact with them and is on call 24/7, we needed to make the caseloads manageable for the specialist so they could see all of their young people and really build those relationships and engagement with the young person. And this is really just a part of our model, and I think it really supports our program and allows us to get those successful outcomes. I think if the caseloads are higher, then we wouldn't be able to have such a successful program.
Great, thank you. And so, Barbara, the next question, we want to circle back to the framework used by the foster care work group, and we've been getting a couple questions in about other documentation, readings, or research that you use to influence the framework used by foster care work group, if you could talk about that.
Sure. We actually reviewed about 9 or 10 other well-being frameworks and did a thorough review of research related to the status of well-being outcomes for young people transitioning out of foster care. So the full report will have all that detail. We're actually just in the process of producing a companion document which goes into greater detail in terms of the review of research that should be out in July, in next January. So stay tuned for that document. The portion in the full investment agenda highlights the array of studies that we reviewed to really put together a composite picture of the status of well-being of young people transitioning from foster care. In terms of the variety of frameworks that we looked at, certainly we tried to build off of and extend ACYF's framework. We looked at frameworks related to adolescent development and emerging adulthood, related to social capital. Also looked at the brain research that has come out of the Jim Casey Youth Opportunities Initiative. So there was a variety of types of frameworks and approaches that we considered in really trying to craft something that we thought was targeted for this particular population of older youth and young adults who had experienced care and really looked at their unique needs and circumstances and strengths and challenges. So I'd point you to that, the full document, and be on the lookout for the review of research piece that should be released in January.
Thank you, Barbara. That's great. And we just want to remind our audience that we will certainly gather these resources from our presenters and post them on the resource page at AYPF.org once our event is over today. I want to open up a few questions to all of our presenters now. We've been getting in several questions about policies that affect this population. So I'm wondering, and Wayne, I think we'll start with you. You specifically mentioned some laws and policies in Kansas that support youth in transition from the foster care system. I'm wondering if you can talk about, elaborate more on those, and also speak to more policies or shifts that are needed. And so Wayne, we'll start with you and then get responses from Mary and Barbara.
Thank you. I did mention some policies that that we have used here in Kansas, and we focused on the great need is, as of course, as youth graduate or emerge from foster care, an adult who is too frequently they have not the proper training, not the preparation necessary. So we have tried to identify efforts to transition young people who may not have the educational requirements. We're trying to work with school districts across the state to make sure that they are getting credit for the time that they have been there. We have worked with school districts to get more consistent in course regulations. The consistency in curriculum that can be passed from school district to school district so that they're insured credits. We invoke the use of the medical card that allows youth to reach out to medical care. We know that youth who are emerging need to be able to support themselves, and so we have done things like provide support for car maintenance even. So it's in the readiness of what can we do to support them in to independence. And so policies around that have been the ones we have been addressing here in Kansas.
That's great. Thank you. And so, Mary, I'm wondering if you can sort of weigh in on the same question, policies to support youth in transition, and maybe identify areas where further work is needed.
Yeah, absolutely. One of the things that Tennessee recently did was opt into fostering connections for young adults until the age of 21. And what that did was free up state dollars that the state was utilizing to provide room and board for some of our youth who were staying in their foster homes while they were pursuing their education. So there's freed up state dollars that they've been able to put into other provider contracts, including our contract, and be able to serve more young adults who are aging out. And also we've been able to leverage private dollars in Tennessee in order to put a $3 million match with the state dollars so we can serve every young person who's aging out of care in Tennessee, and that's roughly 1,000 young people every year. So I would say that that's one of our successes in Tennessee. We've also have a tuition waiver, which I think really helps our young people who are pursuing their post-secondary education. But I would still say that more supports are needed for those young people who aren't at that phase in their life, who are still kind of struggling, and who aren't in school and aren't employed, that's really where I see the greatest need.
Thanks, Mary.
You know,
and then
I might ask, Aaron, I might add to that is looking back at the Jim Casey Initiative and the efforts to try to extend services to youth up to age 21. I think there are a few states now that have extended benefits that would allow the preparation or better preparation for youth to transition with additional supports to allow them educational resources and so forth. So that research and support from Jim Casey would be one that I would reference.
Thanks, Wayne. That's really helpful. And so, Barbara, I'm wondering if we can get your input from your perspective. If the same question, are there, what are the policy supports for this population currently, and if there are any future needs?
Sure. The priority policy changes that the foster care work group recommended, in addition to extending 4E eligibility past the age of 18 to 21 that Mary and Wayne both referenced, are encouraging policies that require the most family-like and least restrictive placement possible. Young people do best when they're raised in supportive families, and the less family-like the placement setting is, it's less likely that that young person's social, emotional, and physical well-being needs will be taken care of. Ending the option of allowing young people to age out of a group setting was another policy priority the foster care work group developed. Again, ensuring well-being, particularly related to social, emotional, and physical well-being, is an important part of transition planning. So as a young person gets ready to transition from the foster care system, that process takes into account developing social and emotional skills and ensuring access to resources that support social, emotional, and physical health. And really taking advantage of the mandate to extend Medicaid coverage to 26 for young people who have experienced care. Ensuring that it's portable from state to state, increasing the healthcare provider community's knowledge of and support for young people transitioning from foster care, considering investments that encourage states to broaden the definition of medical necessity for young people who have experienced trauma, and to encourage and advocate for policies to expand home-based and therapeutic services for older youth in foster care, as well as ensuring minimum benefit levels under Medicaid coverage so that young people have access and coverage to physical and mental health services are some of the policy priorities that the foster care work group highlighted.
That's great. Thank you, Barbara. And we would like to be mindful of our audience's time today, and we will end on that note. But I also want to remind you that this PowerPoint presentation will be posted at www.aypf.org, so you can access the presenters' information as well as their contact information. And we'll be posting the recording on the website shortly after. Once again, we'd really like to thank our speakers today for your fantastic information and insights. And thanks again to our audience for attending our webinar. Have a great afternoon.